Welcome back to the show, everybody. Trust is an important element in any relationship, a bond that is needed when building a strong partnership. But when it comes to the current labor woes in the NHL, I'm not sure there is a lot of trust on either side. So it's a good thing we trust Jeff Merrick and the Hockey Central panel to give us the straight goods.
Alongside Scott Morrison, John Shannon, and Doug McClain, I think it's safe to say that both sides believe that if they shake the other's hand, they'll have to count their fingers afterwards. Is there a significant trust impasse here between the two sides?
Well, I don't know that there was a trespass in the first place.
No, it's never been there.
This has been the biggest dilemma through this whole situation, dating back long before September the 15th, long before anybody ever could figure out if and where they would meet. Trust has been the biggest factor all along, Jeff.
And this stretches back, Doug, you've made this point before. This isn't new in the relationship between the NHL and the Players Association. Go back to the origins of the NHL in 1917 and fast forward to the names we might know, like Ted Lindsay and Carl Brewer.
Yeah, I think it's just a part of the process. I really do. The players have always felt the owners are getting rich. The owners have always thought the players are overpaid. I remember Mike Ilitch saying to Brian Murray and I one night when we signed Steve Yzerman. So, just a minute. Steve Yzerman is going to make more money now than I am, and I'm the owner. And I know that bothered Mike a little bit at that particular time. But, you know, this trust thing goes with negotiations. It's tough, hard negotiations. And, yeah, there's instances happen when people say no to you. All of a sudden, sometimes you don't really trust them. And we know there's been a lot of no's said here in the last little while.
It is a big part of the negotiation process, but this one seems like it's bogged it down here yet again. And when we've looked at the NHL-CBA negotiations the last three times, we've seen shutdowns of some dimension. So this might have been a little bit predictable, but it certainly, even last night, there was a change going on in terms of what happened after midnight, the players feeling that the NHL had changed how it was negotiating at that point, and that's created animosity today. So the mistrust just continues to go on.
Just quickly, I think it really that the mistrust has been now used as a tactic more than anything else in the process.
And I think a lot of it's been manufactured.
All right, then. In the meantime, we'll put our faith with our man standing on the streets of New York City, as chilly as he may be, always with quite a plum and a smile, Ian Mendez.
Yeah, Jeff, thanks so much. The latest here from New York City is that the media is packing up and going home for the night. Much different than last night, where the two sides met until 1 o'clock Eastern time in the morning. Not the case today. They didn't really have any formal bargaining sessions today. They had a meeting that went on in the morning about HRR. They had a little one later on about pensions, but no formal bargaining session where Donald Fehr was in the same room as Gary Bettman. We should point out, though, that the two sides are expected to get together around 10 o'clock, 10:30 a.m. Eastern time tomorrow with the mediator, with the very latest on what was an interesting day here in New York on Thursday. Here's Darren Millard, Nick Kyprios, and Damian Cox.
Ian, I must apologize to you and Damian and Nick and the hockey world, because yesterday there seemed to be some optimism. There was a frenzied emotion around the vote and not filing. And since I showed up, there's been absolutely nothing. How much of a waste of day was this?
A completely wasted day. I mean, there were small groups meeting, but to me, I think this sends such a bad message out to the hockey public and hockey fans out there, where you have two sides who didn't even meet once face-to-face to do some serious bargaining. I think it's appalling. I really think that you're at the stage now where both these sides really believe they're going to get a deal done. But they'll get it done in their own good time, and fans can sit back there and wait. And I just find what happened today really kind of disgusting.
Was this because of the accusation of a bait and switch from the National Hockey League on HRR, or was it about not filing that disclaimer of interest and seemingly leaving yourself wide open?
Well, there's no doubt about it. The players are ticked off on what transpired late last night. Of course, you're talking about the negotiations where the NHL owners literally changed the language of HRR and decided to pull a couple of fast ones over the players, where they weren't allowed to police the HRR, much like they did in the last CBA with fines and first-round draft picks. And you know what? It really ticked off the players a lot.
But that language went back in today.
It did, but obviously it was enough.
They solved it.
No, they didn't solve it. It just wasted more time, much like today was a waste of time.
But don't you think the time for being angry and upset and pointing fingers, that's past?
There's a lack of trust here, Damien. It's always been there. It hasn't gone away. And all that did last night is reiterate to them that they're dealing with someone that possibly doesn't want to meet them anymore in the middle And that's the biggest problem right now.
Does the NHLPA regret not filing that disclaimer of interest?
Well, probably today they do. I think last night maybe they thought it was a sign of good faith. Or maybe they thought, we don't really want to do this right now because of where it may take us. But probably if they were to do it again, given what happened today and given the way everybody's talking, they would have.
And it was Donald Fehr's call, no one else. The board gave him the authority to make that decision on his own. And I think he wanted to give the league the benefit of the doubt to negotiate more. I personally think it was a mistake. I think it showed a sign of weakness. And now they have to come 12 hours later and ask the players to vote again. To me, maybe the one time that Donald Fehr slipped.
Do you guys really think I'm that bad of an influence on fun or things happening?
Just in general. Just in general, yeah. You think so?
I think it's a direct correlation, once again, of you coming down here and derailing things.
Ian from the 13th floor to ground level.
Hey, thanks so much, Jeremy. I'm not sure you're the guy that has derailed this process. So, gentlemen, here's the situation. No more meetings tonight here in Manhattan. They are expected to get together tomorrow at 10:30 a.m. Eastern time with the mediators. I use the word expected because, remember, today, Jeff, they were supposed to get together at 10:30 or around 10 o'clock Eastern time. They actually didn't get into the same room until closer to 1 o'clock. So it's always a big asterisk next to the potential start time of any CBA meeting here in New York.
And we know it wasn't Darren's arrival, but it was John Shannon leaving that drove this thing sideways. We've talked a lot about pensions, guys, but what are some of the other issues still to settle here?
Well, the big one, the biggest one, might just still be the salary cap. We've all talked all along about the league not wanting to move off that $60 million cap for the short year and the first 82-game season year, as well as, you know, trying to find a way to keep the six-year contracts and seven-year contracts if you sign your own free agents. The players are wanting to push those numbers a bit.
And there's no agreement on the term of the CBA overall.
Or the variance in contracts.
The bigger issue on the salary cap, the $60 million cap is one thing, but the 44 floor is a real issue, and the lesser teams, the bottom 10 or so, do not want to see that move off the 44. And I'm also being told, other than one team, maybe the New York Rangers, all other teams are happy with the $60 million.
And just to put it in perspective math-wise, everybody says, well, it's only $5 million. Over a year period with 30 clubs, that's about $165 million. You do it for 2 years, that's $330 million. And if you put that money back on the table for all the teams to share, everybody makes money. So it is a big deal.
And we should mention there are no guarantees that tomorrow the full group meets. It could be the mediator going back and forth with the two sides.
It will be the mediator going back and forth. That's what his job is.
And how about this for other issues as well? These were big last year. We haven't even mentioned them once. What about the Olympics? And what about realignments?